Oh, so.
No.
More about gel coat.
When the force.
Don't you call in the. More importantly.
Welcome back, Diana Eden. Hello.
Hello. Good to see you again.
It's so great to talk to you again. Matthew is also here. He was just telling you how excited he was seeing that you were able to finally make a trip to New York and see some shows recently.
Yes. Yes. And it reminded me how amazing Broadway shows are. I mean, the level of performance and artistry and the size of the theaters being small, the experience is just incredible.
Mm-hmm. And you even got to go to some of your old haunts and stomping grounds from your Broadway days, didn't you?
I did, yes. I was outside what used to be the old Alvin Theater. Mm-hmm. Now it's the Neil Simon, and saw them loading in the show. And I was hovering and peeking in the stage door. And someone kind of came up and said, "Yes, can I help you?" So I gave him my little song and dance about I used to perform at this theater and I just wanted to see it. And they gave me a little private tour inside.
Oh, that's so nice.
Yeah. So
that is great.
Made me feel welcome and part of the Broadway community, which I just loved.
Yeah, that's, I mean, actor, we're a special breed, all of us, really. Yourself included, in terms of stop scoffing. There is such a different sense of workplace family in the type of work that we do versus being in an office.
Oh, yes.
Or something like that. And I saw you also got to Palm Springs for a signing for your book.
Yes, I did indeed. And was delighted that my mentor and inspiration, Bob Mackey, came to my book signing. So that was really fabulous.
What a thrill to see a photo of you with him on your Instagram feed. And that was a total surprise.
Yeah.
Wow. What a mensch.
Well, I had written him and said, "I'd love it if you come." You know, I didn't really think he would. He's such a celebrity in Palm Springs. And he has a book of his own coming out. And he's doing his own book signing in about a week. So I thought, well, he won't come. But he did.
That was so sweet.
Yeah, he's a very kind and generous man. And you talk to almost any costume designer, you know, that's my contemporary, and they will say that they got their start with Bob, or Bob helped them, or, you know, Bob was part of so many designers' careers.
Mm-hmm. Great. So we have summoned you here, of course, to discuss the season premiere of season 8, where Mrs. Garrett gets married and we have all the beautiful costumes there. But before we actually get to that, may I ask you a couple of other broader questions to which you may not know or have any answers, but I just thought wouldn't hurt to ask.
Go ahead.
All right. First and foremost, were you on the floor of the soundstage when the tapings were happening? Were you actually in that room?
Yes, absolutely. Always.
You were. Okay. So it wasn't like you were just in the workroom cranking them out and an assistant was there to baste a hem?
No.
So, okay. You were in the room where it happened. Huh?
Yes.
Knowing that, as you've told us before, it was a busy show. You had to crank out a lot of costumes, and most of the time you were just keeping your head down, getting the work done. Were you friendly at all with any of the writers?
Yes, I was actually, because they were part of the whole process. You see, the writers would be at the first read through. Because they had to hear how the girls delivered the lines and what worked and what didn't. So they were at the table for the first Monday morning read through. Then, of course, rehearsals. Then we have our big camera blocking day and dress rehearsal on Thursday. And now the writers are really there seeing what is working and what they need to change. And they're sometimes changing the lines right at the last minute. And then, of course, Friday night, we do two shows, a 4 o'clock and a 7 o'clock. And very often, based on the laughs that came or didn't come at the 4 o'clock show, they would change some lines, change some jokes for the 7 o'clock show. So they were around a lot.
And you did collaborate then with them.
Yes, yes. I also used to like to go into the booth, the writer's booth, where they watch the taping. And let me tell you, it was kind of brutal, but there were two viewing booths. One was the one where the director and all the technical people were doing the switching, you know, camera one, camera three, back to camera one, and the producers were, and there wasn't always room for me. So I went to the other booth, which was where the writers were sitting. And I made the mistake once of telling a really stupid joke, and it fell on such deaf ears, silence, and they looked at me like, what are you doing in our space? So I kind of backed out, never made that mistake again.
Stay in your lane, honey.
Exactly, exactly. But no, the writers were very much part of the whole ensemble. They were part of the whole process.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Yeah.
So with season 8 beginning, this is the arrival of Cloris Leachman. I'm wondering, at what point were you and the rest of the team informed that Charlotte Ray was going to be leaving the show? And were there rumblings ahead of that? Was there any rumors before there was confirmation?
I honestly don't remember. I think probably she had made her wishes known, or I don't remember anything going on, but it could have been. We were, of course, very eager to know who the new person was going to be. And when we heard Cloris Leachman, we were kind of like, how is she going to fit in? Mm-hmm. So it was quite fascinating.
And did you hear any rumors of whom they were considering?
If I did, I don't remember.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a long time ago. Talk. I've heard some that they actually shot an episode with Marion Ross from Happy Days. And what? I'm like, well, if that happened, Diana would have costumed it. There wasn't a different pilot or another consideration that you're aware of?
No, and I know Marion Ross because I designed and made a costume for her one woman show. So unless this was before I arrived on scene.
Mm-hmm. It's again, the rumors we talked about some of these last time we had you on, of there are these strange things that grow and take on a life of their own, because there's a whole list of considerations out there. And I'm in touch with a couple of the fan site moderators on Facebook. Yeah. And even they're like, don't know where I heard this, don't know where this came from. Mm-hmm. But there was talk of Florence Henderson, Michael Learned, Shirley Jones, Catherine Helmand.
And there might well have been any of those, you know. At the time, I was just busy getting the show together. And, I imagine a number of people were considered. I mean, Marion Ross would have been wonderful replacing the Mrs. Garrett type character. Mm-hmm. When they brought in Cloris Leachman, there was no way it was going to be the same type of, you know, baking cookies kind of character.
Thank you for that. This is so nice to have someone that's an actual source there. And those could have been names that one writer threw out in one meeting and someone overheard, and now somehow it's, you know, the game of telephone.
And casting, you know, I'm sure casting, they didn't just pick one person and that was the only person that, I'm sure the casting department was looking at a lot of possibilities.
Yeah.
And, you know, all of those people that you named were sort of NBC people. It could well have been those people that were under consideration, and maybe someone was even approached and turned it down. I just don't have privy to that information anymore.
Okay. Well, you have written about your initial meetings and conversations with Cloris Leachman.
Yes.
And what a character she was.
Oh, yes. And, yes.
So with this, before Cloris Leachman even arrives in the episode, we do have this weird fantasy funeral scene that goes on. It's like a nightmare in Mrs. Garrett's mind, where it's her funeral and she doesn't take the chance and go to the Peace Corps with Bruce. So this is what her life would have ended up like. Do you have any recollections of what it was like taping the funeral scene with Charlotte in a casket, which is,
No, I don't. And I don't remember that at all.
No, no worries at all. There was another joke there that directly was a costuming joke where Blair comes in a red dress. And she says, I killed Mrs. Garrett because she was boring me to death. And so they say, no jury of my peers would convict me. And if you recall, a group of young 20-ish pretty blonde girls stand up in the back, tear off their veils, and they are all dressed in identical red dresses and hats as yes. Blair. And yes. I was like, oh, that's a Diana.
Yes, yes, indeed.
It's very fun. It's a very fun scene.
Yes.
So, Matthew, do you have anything you wanted to ask before we actually talk and get into the bridal attire?
No, I just love being in your presence. And I realize like how silly it is. Like, you know, like if somebody asked me a job that I worked 40 years ago and was like, hey, do you remember that? I'd be like, I worked at Dairy Queen. That's all I know. So we realize how ridiculous it is to like pick your brain about this. And I'm so grateful that you've come on and like we get to talk to you about this ridiculous thing.
I love talking to you guys. But sometimes I think, oh my goodness, why don't I remember more? But there are certain things that will stick out. And a couple of them, I have a feeling we're going to be talking about in 60 seconds.
Okay. There was that great episode of Saturday Night Live with William Shatner at a Star Trek convention.
Oh, yes.
All the Trekkies saying, so in season 2, episode 14, what was the combination of the locker?
Oh, yes.
And William Shatner ends up going on this tirade about what a ridiculous waste of time this is. Get a life, you losers. And it's true because it was like that was 3 years of his entire life.
Yeah.
And he hasn't watched the episodes 170 times. He performed them and then went on to the next thing.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
We absolutely get it. So let's talk then about the bridal costumes. Tell us everything about Mrs. Garrett's bridal dress and about the four gorgeous bridesmaids dresses that the girls are wearing.
Okay, well, I will first talk about Mrs. Garrett because that we can discuss quickly, and then I'll tell you the many versions of the bridesmaids dresses. Mrs. Garrett, when we had the various design meetings and discussions, they said, well, definitely she's not going to be in white. That would be silly. Mm-hmm. So let's just make her a very pretty cocktail dress. And, you know, I talked it over with Charlotte and she always loved blue for her eyes. And so I sketched up, you know, a very pretty dress and found a lovely kind of turquoisey, turquoise is too bright a color, but, you know, pretty aqua blue chiffon. And, you know, I had a wonderful workroom right there at the studio and they made the dress and we had fittings. And the only thing was, in typical fashion, Charlotte picked apart every detail. And, you know, I know there's Charlotte fans out there and I'm going to come off as sounding like, you know, I'm anti-Charlotte, but she was difficult to fit because she was so insecure about the way she looked that every little pleat, every little gathering had to be rearranged a half a dozen times. And I had a wonderful and very patient seamstress costume maker. And we think we'd be all finished. And then Charlotte would say, see this little gathering right here by the bust. I think that's just, can we lose that a little bit? And I would look at Hosmick and, you know, because for her that meant picking apart, you know, just for one little pleat, there's a lot of work. But, you know, it got done, and eventually it was the way she liked it. And we had a happy actress, which is what we need, you know?
Sure. So that one was an original that you designed.
Oh, yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
We talked about you designing Nancy McKeon's wedding gown for season 9. That's coming down the pike a little bit.
Yes.
So how's about those bridesmaids outfits? What is the scene? Well, you imply there's some stories there.
It's stories because the what you saw was version number 3.
Oh.
Yes. I do not remember the first versions, to be honest, but in discussions with the producers about what they should look like, I said, you cannot put the 4 girls in the same style. Their shapes and personalities are so different. And they said, no, they must be in the same dress. So I went out and bought kind of typical bridesmaids dresses, and you know, you couldn't have 4 figures that were more different.
So
I show them, we have what we call rack approval, which means once everything is fit and ready for dress rehearsal, everything for the show is lined up on a wardrobe rack, and Rita Dillon, the producer at the time, and some of the other, for important shows, sometimes the writers, sometimes the executive producer will come and approve everything. Well, they looked at those dresses and they looked at them on the girls and they said, no, this is just not going to work. And this was Thursday and we taped Friday.
Oh my God. Yeah. And you're like, that's what I said.
Oh. I thought, what am I going to do? So I went downtown LA, where they have all the wholesalers and all of the dresses for the, I can never say this right, quinceañera, the...
Oh, quinceañera.
Yeah.
Yes.
Dresses.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm laughing because I found lace dresses in 4 different colors. An orange, a lavender, a blue, and a, who knows, green probably, that were in the right sizes. And I brought them back and he said, you know, we've got very little time. We've got to fit, brought the girls in early on, you know, Friday morning, fit them, altered them, and said, okay, I've got 4 dresses that are different, but they're all the same lace. So we're actually about to tape and they look at the dresses on camera and they were so horrified that they said, we can't tape the wedding.
Oh,
true story. They said, we are going to finish taping the show except for the wedding and we will tape it next week. That is how disastrous I could have been fired. I mean, because, you know, this is major.
Mm-hmm.
And how embarrassing for me.
And it was just that they were unflattering, or is it that the lace read differently, or is it sheer?
No, I mean, it was a lace over a taffeta, probably. Mm-hmm. And it's just that they were, I mean, you can't. Bridesmaids dresses are pretty ugly anyway. And if you do someone in orange lace, you know, you'd have to be pretty brilliant to pull it off.
So they put off the taping. That is at great time and expense. Oh my gosh.
I know.
Wow.
So fortunately, I wasn't fired. They didn't bring in someone to replace me. I guess they figured that, I knew the girls better than anyone. So I went shopping once again. And I went to a store on La Cienega called Bazaar CM, BAZAAR, and then the initial CM, where I'd once, by the way, name dropping, saw Barbara Streisand shopping. Oh. Yes. Anyway, it was a very hip, current, wonderful store that had kind of unique things. And I found 2 of the matte jersey dresses there. They were quite expensive for the time, but they were soft, pretty colors, and they were each a different style, but they would had the same quality of fabric. Mm-hmm. So I either bought them or got them out on memo, probably bought them, and brought them back and said, I can make two more dresses in this theme in the week, if you will let me go this route. They are not bridesmaid dresses. They don't have full puffy skirts. They don't have puffy sleeves, but they are elegant and sophisticated, and they work with Mrs. Garrett's turquoise dress.
Yes.
So they weren't sure, but they said, okay. So I went and bought the matte jersey fabric and had two more dresses made so that each girl had a dress that suited her figure. And that's what we ended up with.
And it's matte jersey. That's what I couldn't tell what the fabric was, but it looks so lovely and soft and hangs.
Yes. So it has a beautiful drape to it.
Yes. Wow. So you designed two of the four.
Yes.
Of the bridesmaids. That is incredible.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah. Well, third time's the charm.
I know. Yeah, that's crazy. And it's true. You don't think about it. It's like, this is your job. And you're like, oh God, is this a big enough thing that they might say, well, does she have what it takes to cut the mustard around here? Maybe we need to find someone else. That's always so scary.
I know. And I'd never really feared for my job until that moment. But when they said, we can't film the wedding, it's just too awful. Whoops.
You were still kind of the newbie there.
Newbie, yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
That is something.
So I have one other story, and this is a story on Nancy McKeon, and I hope she will forgive me if she does hear about this, but it's a true story.
I promise she will never listen to this show, but go ahead. Anything can happen.
Nancy was in her tomboy phase of, I will not wear high heels.
Yes, I remember you saying that. Yes.
And so I said, oh, Nancy, come on. You've got this soft jersey dress. You've got to wear just a low heel. Nope. I'm going to wear little flat white lace-up shoes and socks. I said, you can't do that. So she would not hear of it for any change. So I had now to go to my producer. Was at the time Irma Kalish. And when I said, Irma, I have tried everything, but Nancy will not wear dress shoes with her bridesmaid's dress. And Irma said, oh, that's ridiculous. That's absolutely ridiculous. I'll go talk to her. So Irma, who was like 4'10" and just a pistol, went, good talk with her, and then came back and said, oh, well, apparently she won't wear heels. So Irma said, well, I'll go talk to the network. Well, there were these network people who were part of it. And she went, and the network people said, well, that's ridiculous. We'll go talk to Nancy. And they went and talked to Nancy, and Nancy said, no. So if you look very carefully, you will see in the pictures that Nancy is wearing little white lace-up, kind of like kids, but I think they were more like leather, you know. And little white socks.
Mm-hmm. There are a couple of full length shots, particularly when she's answering the door, and you know Beverly Ann is supposedly backing the Winnebago into the driveway and stuff. But no, there are a couple of very clear shots where that was one of my questions on my list was, what was the deal with Nancy's shoes and socks?
What's the deal? Nancy won over the powerful network people, the executive producer, and you know. So,
Man, that is hilarious. I mean, who would think? And she was, what, 20 at the time? She was still... Yeah, I mean, yeah, she wasn't a teenager. She was a grown-up, but stood her ground.
Yeah.
Oh, to have been a fly on the wall. Because you think like when the network gets called in, everybody gets they walked into Nancy's office. She went, yeah, no, I'm not wearing that. And they were like, okay, Nancy, sorry. Yeah. I love that.
Well, you know, in the long run, when you have a hit show, and by now we're how many seasons in? Yeah.
Yeah.
They're not, eventually, the star is going to win out, even though it may not be the right choice. And that's why actors, you know they have a lot of power. Now, the problem comes when they are just in their first season or when they think they're hot stuff and they really aren't hot stuff. You know, then a producer can say, well, I'm sorry, you won't wear that. We're terminating your contract. But when you're six seasons or eight seasons in and the show is a mega hit, I mean, if she said, I want to wear zebra stripes, they might have said, okay, Nancy, go ahead. I don't know. It's just, yeah. And
honestly, Lo, in the long run, I mean, was it right for the character? Because I'll be honest, when I saw them, when I saw them in the episode, I was like, yep, that is exactly what Joe would put on with that dress.
Yes. So, yeah.
I don't know.
Well, it's such a funny thing about weddings in general. I mean, I think it's changing a bit now, but I always find the whole tradition of having what I call your backup singers, you know, your bridesmaids, all dressed in the identical ugly dress. And, you know, there's always one that it doesn't look very good on. And it's just, I've always, when I've designed weddings, I've tried to at least make the bridesmaids look similar but different, you know. Mm-hmm. Even for my own wedding, nobody was dressed like identical backup singers.
And you can see that you can get that effect. This is, you know, and this show, this is 1986, where there are these four beautiful, elegant, appropriate dresses. They're unified by the fabric and by mm-hmm. the tones of colors, but they're all so individual. It's, mm-hmm. I mean, it is exquisite. It's strikingly beautiful. And
thank you.
All these years later, I cannot say enough bravos with how lovely visually this episode is for that reason.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, it's rewarding to know that when I was so early in my own career as a costume designer, then that I was able to produce something that gives you such pleasure. That's lovely.
So another weird question now, not related to the dresses or the gowns or whatever. Mm-hmm. Did anybody ever mention, or was it ever addressed or understood, the fact that everybody in the cast on the show had either an April or a May birthday?
No, it wasn't. And the funny thing is, in the rehearsal hall during the week, every time someone had a birthday, everyone would stop and the prop guy would bring out a birthday cake and we'd sing and it would be great fun. And then of course we wrapped in March. And the fact that Kim, Mac, and I, and the lighting designer, Don, all had May 12th as our birthdays, we never got the cake or the song or the applause or anything. So yeah.
But you were not alone, because similarly, Charlotte Ray, Cloris Leachman, Nancy McKeon, Lisa Welchel, and Mindy Cohn, all, and including Clooney, as well as Mac, all of them, April or May birthdays. It's so weird.
I don't think anyone has ever pointed that out. Oh, I think you should do a whole podcast on that.
An expose.
You obviously don't listen. We've talked about the girls' ages, Diana. Ad nauseum. This one over here.
I obsess over their ages because the show, they didn't put as much weight on the show Bible in those days. Yeah. So in, you know, as we go along, the girls were de-aged a year in a season where Joe has to be 20. Someone refers to her as 19. It's like, no, that's not right. It gets me a little bit.
You know, they had to keep, as long as they were committed to the story with Charlotte and, you know, having the girls living with a headmistress or a whatever, you know, they had to keep them young enough.
That's it. And so Matthew, is there anything else you wanted to ask Diana before we go?
I cannot tell you how many times this season, because we've just finished season 7, how many times we have actually said out loud, how amazing Charlotte Rae looks this season.
Oh, good.
The colors you put her in, the jewel tones that you used on her, you made her look 10 years younger than she looked when the show started. So I'm wondering if she was that hard on you, making her look that good. How difficult was she before? When they were dressing her so frumpy.
When I interviewed, one of the things they were looking for is someone who had the temperament to deal with four teenagers, hard enough as it is, and with Charlotte. So, I guess I, in my interview, conveyed that I could be patient and I could, you know, work with people. And the girls were pretty much no problem. I mean, not everything I brought in worked on them. Sometimes they didn't like things. Sometimes they did. Most of the time they did. And what, you know, once you get to know what works for them, it's pretty easy. But with Charlotte,
It seems that she was just particular. She wasn't maliciously, no. I'm here to make it difficult. She just was very persnickety. And we know in any field, when you have a customer who is persnickety, it's always.
Yeah. And she was around four young women, you know, who all had their own kind of beauty. And she was middle-aged. And, you know, that's challenging for a lot of people.
Yeah. We were watching her in the first season of Different Strokes, the predecessor show. And we also caught an episode of Phyllis that she did in 1975 with Cloris Leachman. And Matthew commented both times, he's like, how does she look 10 years older here than she does currently in 1986 and season seven and eight of The Facts of Life? Because she does really look wonderful.
Oh, well, great. Yeah.
Well, anything else, Matthew, before we move on?
No, like I said, you did such amazing work on that show. And for these two old queens to get to like talk to the person who totally gave the facts of life a brand new look. It's just, thank you so much for taking your time and talking to us about it. You're just an amazing human being. I love that we've kind of created, dare I say, a friendship. And I adore you, and I think you're amazing. And thanks for making it look good.
thank you. Well, don't be afraid to ask for more episodes coming up, whether I remember or not. I'll always tell you if there's a story.
Oh, no, we appreciate that so much. Your generosity is incredible. And Stars in Their Underwear, your memoir is still out there. Do you have any other book signings planned or any other events?
No, I don't. But I have one little exciting, it's very, very minimal, but exciting for me. When I got my royalty check this past month, there was a couple of books sold in Europe. Somebody over there has heard about it, you know? So, and as far as I know, it wasn't a relative. So that was kind of exciting. And I am doing a podcast, I think next weekend, with a person who has a show up in Canada. So hopefully more Canadian sales. And
That's great. Well, we've recommended the book so many times, and we always try to plug it on the show whenever we can. So Stars in Their Underwear, you know how much Matthew and I love the book and love your writing. So
thank you.
Thank you again, Diana. This has been great. And we look forward to talking to you again sometime soon.
Okay. All right. Okay. Bye.
No, more about gel coat.
When the force...
Don't you call in the... More importantly...